Hey, Honey Bash. It is the 16th of March, 2019. I've been following this Israeli moon lander, and they started this countdown this week. And apparently they do not tweet on the Sabbath. I get it. But regardless, I was looking into some other things and just kind of like searching out, you know, Israel's place in this whole space situation here. And one thing I did notice on this countdown that began with the 8-day countdown and ends on the 21st on the equinox, okay? This is just something I discovered, okay? It ends on Purim, that countdown, 8 days. But if you look at the history of this day, when you click this little history situation here, it's very, very interesting because the 21st, according to this history right here, the 21st will be the 8th day of Moses' life back in 1393 BC, on which he was circumcised in accordance to the divine commandment to Abraham. Okay? So this countdown matches up perfectly to the countdown from birth until his circumcision. Another interesting thing indeed. And there's a bunch actually. There's more than I can really share with you. It's so much. Another thing that I thought was really interesting too. If we look at the name of this little moon lander, okay? Beresheet. Take that word right there, and you can literally take it and spell Esther. B. That's what's left over. After you spell Esther, you have B-E-E left over. That's really weird, and I don't even know how I came to understand and see that, but that to me is very strange. You know, and this countdown ends on the Feast of Esther, Purim, rather. Feast of Esther, then Purim. This is really strange. Now, I was looking into the Israel history, like I said, and I came across this article here. Okay, this is from the 26th of February. Very interesting here. Israel 21C, that's interesting. Did you know Israel sent a rocket into space in 1961? Again, with the 69. This time, with the 11 bookmarks on it. And I was showing you how Apollo 11 was their last post on their tweeter, 1969. 8 years earlier, Israel blasted off their own rocket. So there's that 8 again. And I'm looking at this article, right? Look at this clock right here. This is their little space center. 2:46. This is the same word that I've been running into over and over and over again. Hebrew 2:4-6. The chains. Okay? Seriously. I mean, I continually encounter that word. The ligaments, the DNA, the chains. Israelis were bursting with pride on Friday, February 22nd, 2019, when the first blue and white spacecraft successfully blasted off in the first ever privately funded moon mission. And it's funded by all these billionaire oligarchs who are all part of the synagogue of Satan. The initiative marks the next step in Israel's space agency's stated goal: increase Israel's relative lead in this field and position the country amongst the leading nations involved in space research and its exploration. The notion that this tiny sliver of a country could be a leader in spaceflight and exploration is rooted in part with the Israeli Air Force. In September 1948, at the height of the War of Independence and the IAF battles against the Egyptian Air Force, the first edition of the IAF magazine featured a United Press article entitled, "What Do You Think About Flying to Mars?" And this is in 1948. They were already indoctrinating everybody. Even before that, the Hebrew, the Yiddish language periodicals frequently published articles about space exploration. And you would think that these people would know their Bibles better than anyone, and that the earth is stationary and on foundations. It's a 1947 book, Yitzhak Evnon, about a boy and his dog who flew to the red planet in a rocket ship. You see that? They were indoctrinating the kids in. In 1957, in the run-up to the Jewish New Year, children's weekly magazine, Devar Yeladim, published a story written by Uriel Ofek with pictures by Nahum, the well-known artist and illustrator. In doggerel rhyme, the heroes of Magan, David, to the moon. Two young kibbutzniks named Gad and Rami reflect on the year gone by and wonder how they can contribute to research. They hit upon the idea of building a kite that can fly to the moon. A kite. Although some grown-up foreign scientists attempt to compete by launching a rocket, in the end, the boys win a gold medal. Notice their kite is strikingly like a fish, it looks like to me. This is very weird, but it gets better. The story became real only a few months later with the October 1957 launch of the Soviet Union Sputnik satellite, just as this event thrust the United States into high gear to win the space race. So Israel was galvanized into action. The IEF magazine devoted almost its entire December issue to Sputnik. More significantly, Prime Minister David Ben-Gurion expressed interest in space exploration. At the opening of the Knesset winter session, with Sputnik 3 weeks into orbit, 3 weeks, 21 days, and this happens to be on Israel 21C, just saying, into its orbit, Ben-Gurion said, "There's no doubt that the most important event which took place during the holidays was the successful launch of an artificial moon." Now that's an interesting little terminology right there, don't you think? An artificial moon into the atmosphere by Russian scientists. This perhaps opens up a new era in man's domain over cosmic space. So this Sputnik thing got him going. Ben-Gurion knew that the USSR's potential to control the skies overhead posed a real threat to Israel, as the Egyptian Air Force, you notice it's the Egyptian Air Force, right? Had access to advanced technologies from Russia. In addition, Gamal Abdel Nasser, at that point president of the United Arab Republic, the Union of Egypt and Syria from 58 to 61, had recruited German rocket scientists. Really? Egypt recruited German rocket scientists, former Nazis. You mean they got the scraps after Russia and the United States took who they wanted. That's what happened. It just goes on and on. But what I came to find, and there's some interesting things. Notice how they call it a moon, an artificial moon. And this is all about Russia and Sputnik, right? Well, get a load of this, right? This is crazy to me. But I went and I looked up the Sputnik, and I have it here. And this little basketball-sized globe here was shot up into space on October the 4th of 1957. When I put that into the calculator, I mean, you gotta just get a load of this. You know what I'm saying? October 10th, 1957. When we could go to today and just include the day, but also tomorrow, it's exactly 22,444 days. Now, I just thought that was a little too coincidental to just ignore. You know what I mean? Then I see it's 737 months, and we have all these airplanes, these, what do you call it? These 737 airplanes that are all being grounded now. You know what I mean? This is happening all around the world. Airlines are grounding the 737 MAX 8, and it's also an 8. Which is the same thing as this countdown that they're doing here. The same thing, it matches perfectly with Moses' birth up to his circumcision, which will fall on Purim, which is also the solstice, which is also a supermoon. Okay? It just goes on and on and on, you guys. And remember, back in 1969, where they're talking about Apollo, sixth of the countdown, 1969, that the Jewish calendar lined up perfectly with the same year that Christ was crucified, because Nisan 1 actually fell in the proper place when the year does actually begin, the first day of spring, 1969. So this stuff just piles up and piles up, and I have no idea exactly what to make of it, other than we're just inching ever so close to this world being turned on its head in a big, big way. If you think it's crazy now, you've seen nothing yet. So find peace, security in Christ Jesus, because no man can offer it up. It just is not possible. Christ is the only Savior, so seek Him out first, above all things. And there's, as usual, 8 million things we could go through on this. That might be a little bit of an exaggeration, but a lot. And this has so much to do with everything. It's just unreal. It's unreal. Praise God, though. He gives us His peace, surpasses all understanding. And I pray this blesses someone. I truly do. Peace and grace to y'all. Many fish.
Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God,